Yeah, good morning, everybody. No, we seem to be live. Welcome to this week's EMinar. And today we have Paul Bedrosian giving the second in a series of three talks on national magnetotelluric programs. We had Sign a Probe in December, and we have the Australian OSLAM next month. And this today we're going to hear from Paul on Unveiling a Continent, the US Array magnetotelluric program. Next week, we have Pierre Warzyniak and Farid Smay talking about their open source Python library called Erazorback for robust processing. We had a couple of good talks on processing MT data recently. And then the week after is Anna Marty talking on MT response functions. Week after that, we've got a very special invited talk from Ali Reza Malimia, who was the lead of an EU program called Smart Exploration, New Ways to Explore the Subsurface. It was primarily seismology. There was some in EM in it. But I think it's very useful to hear from Ali Reza how these programs go and what the objectives are from an EU perspective, and see if we can build things and collaborate. The week after that, we have the Australian version, Stefan Thiel on OSLAM, Illuminating Australia's Lithosphere. And then Alison Kirkby, another Aussie, giving us an overview of MTPy. I know a lot of you are using this, the Python-based MT processing and display framework. And then early first week of March, we have a seminar from Doug. Doug will start off the series on inversions. And Doug will give us a seminar on a webinar on fundamentals of inversion. Really looking forward to that. And directly following the week after, we have Lindsay Higgy, who's going to talk about, well, she's been working with Doug for many years now. She's going to be talking about how you capture knowledge in code using SIMPEG and GSI. And third week of March, we have Costanza Manacero, who works with Juan Carlos Alfonso of Macquarie, who's talking about probabilistic conversion of 3D magnetotelluric data. I think you'll be really impressed with how some approximate solutions, very fast approximate solutions, can take us a long way in the inversion of MT data. And then the last week of March, almost the last week of March, we have Juliana Hubert on space weather, GICs and MT. So just to remind you once more that all the information about these are on the webpage, the EMinar's webpage. And here you can find a video link and presentation to past ones and registration link for upcoming ones. And I think most of you know now that this is a webinar, so it doesn't have all the features that that a Zoom meeting has. So you've got four things you can do. You can change your audio settings. You can send a chat message primarily to panelists, but that can go wider than that. You can raise your hand. I mean, towards the end, if you're really eager to speak, you can raise your hand and we can authorize you to speak if you want to get into a discussion. And then finally, the Q&A box. And this is one that is where you send questions to the presenter. And then Paul will answer those either on the fly or at the end of the webinar. So today, just to remind you, we have Paul Bedrosian, and I was going to read Paul's CV before we went live. We went live fast on it. So I'll let Paul introduce himself. Yeah, Paul, if you want to come live.
Let's see here. Whoops.
Tell us a bit about yourself.
Yeah, right. All right. I'll do a little quick self-intro. So thanks. Thanks first to Alan and Max and the organizers for really putting together this series. I did my PhD with Martin Unsworth and John Booker at the University of Washington. Then moved on to a postdoc as a Alexander von Humboldt fellow at the GFZ in Potsdam, and then moved across to the USGS where I started as a Mendenhall fellow and have been a research geophysicist ever since. And yeah, a lot of my interests are in sort of framework tectonics, the application of EM methods, both natural MT and controlled source EM, to a variety of problems from geology tectonics to natural hazards, volcanic hazards, as well as resource studies. So I was fortunate to become somewhat involved in the US National MT Array program starting back in around 2008. And so, yeah, I'm gonna talk a little bit about that today and give you kind of an overview of that program. So with that, I'm gonna share a screen here. Oops. Right, okay. So I assume that somebody's gonna pipe up if you're unable to see my screen or the laser pointer here.
No, you're good, Paul. I can see.
All right. Screen, the laser pointer. So yeah, thanks again for the opportunity to present this. So yeah, I'm gonna talk about the US Array MT program. And I really wanna state up front that I'm a bit, just really a messenger here. This is a program that over the past two decades has involved, you know, a tremendous amount of work and effort from a large cast of characters. And I'll try to call a few of them out at the end, but you know, I really am just the messenger here. So as a bit of an outline, I'll talk a little bit about the background and history of the USMT array. I'll go through some of the various components of this program. And I think this is important because it highlights kind of some of the aspects that really have made it a success. We'll then look at the data set itself, what we're terming the US National Impedance Map. And then we'll sort of transition and talk about a few science vignettes. And this is not an effort to do any sort of comprehensive review of the science that's come out of this project. And rather, I'm gonna actually kind of shamelessly look at three sort of different applications, which I've been involved to some degree in. So the US Magnetotelluric Array, or what I'm gonna call MT Array, is really kind of a composite of a number of different funding sources that have sort of seen it from its conception in 2003 to its completion a few years down the road. And probably the initial and one of the largest components of it was the EarthScope program, which was a US National Science Foundation funded program that ran for 15 years. And this program was really focused on understanding the structure and dynamics of the North American continent, in particular looking at sort of crustal and lithospheric scales. But somewhere along the way in that program, it became increasingly recognized that magnetotellurics has an important role to play in understanding space weather hazards. And in particular, understanding the role of solid earth connectivity in modulating geomagnetically induced currents, which can have deleterious effects on critical infrastructure such as power lines. And so that recognition really was important in leading to sort of the follow-on funding after the EarthScope program twilighted, in particular NASA funding for a couple of years and starting last year funding by the US Geological Survey. And the current path has the completion of the contiguous United States occurring around 2023 or 2024. So the very first stations for EarthScope went in the ground around 2004, and those were seismic stations. But it's worth emphasizing that it was a long road to get there. The science planning actually began back in 1993. And so there was more than a decade with lots of workshops and opportunity for community input, white papers written, et cetera. And it all kind of culminated in a project plan in 2001. And that really set the stage for what became the first proposal, which was a real big proposal to effectively purchase equipment and establish the facilities. And that was to the tune of $70 million. Now, MT did have a role in this, but it was a relatively small role. And it basically was sort of the capital cost to purchase about 30 long period instruments. So The actual bulk of Earthscope, however, was through operations and maintenance, which ran for about 12 years. And this was on the order of $20 million a year to operate the components of this array. And MT was about 5% of that. So it was a relatively small percentage, but importantly, the sort of the size of MT over the lifetime roughly doubled. So this is a, as a kind of a fun fact, you can sort of see this as you go through these various documents. In this original project plan, MT got one mention. By the time you get to this next sort of equipment proposal, it got mentioned 8 times, but misspelled once. And by the time you get to sort of the operations, first operations proposal, it's mentioned more than 30 times, but still misspelled several times. So MT definitely was growing importance through the course of this program. So Earthscope had multiple components, but the one where MT was housed is termed US Array. And so this was really a geophysical array which was meant to sweep across the nation. And what's shown on the right here is the seismic array. And so the seismic array consisted of about 200 instruments which marched as a swath from west to east across the nation with a nominal 70 kilometer station spacing. The MT component was a little bit different. It stuck to the 70 kilometer spacing, but as opposed to the seismic component, MT never had quite the resources, be it financial or instrumentation, to cover the entire US in this manner. So it was restricted to targeted footprints, or and these areas were determined through a number of community siting workshops, and it was settled on an initial footprint in the northwestern US and a subsequent footprint in the mid-continent. And then it grew from there. So the MT again was on the same spacing, but it consisted of a long period instrument in the ground for 3 weeks minimum. There was also a backbone array, which consisted of 7 stations spread throughout the nation. And these were with longer recordings on the order of 2 years. And the idea was to try to actually get long period data capable of imaging down through the mantle transition zone. Another component of the US array was what was termed the flexible array. And this was designed to be a separate pool of instruments sort of available at the ready for PI-driven science. And while that did in fact transpire for the seismic component, MT kind of had to share. So there were never really dedicated instruments for the flex array, but the same instruments used for the transportable array also supported these PI-driven experiments. But the upside of this is the Earthscope program, right from the get-go, actually had research funding embedded within it. So there were funds for a number of PI-driven MT experiments that transpired through the course of this program. And then finally, there was a robust sort of education and outreach component. There's considerable student involvement, various phases of community involvement, and a number of teaching workshops at various levels. So any national data set is only as good as the instrumentation which is used to record it. And so the USMT array relied upon the NIMS instrument. So this is the long period instrument that was manufactured by Barry Nayrod. It's a one hertz sampling rate. And I think one of the hallmarks of the MT array is that this instrument has been used from start to finish. So you have a very consistent data set from the beginning to the end. Now, the caveat to that is there are considerable challenges in maintaining instrumentation over a long life cycle, especially when it's in heavy use. And so I think a real important point to make here is that Earthscope established an instrument facility. So this was the National Geoelectromagnetic Facility run by Adam Schultz out of Oregon State University. And this provided engineering support, repairs, upgrades, and sort of all the ancillary equipment needed to make this array fly. And it's also, I think, worth pointing out that the magnetic sensors used for this are flux gate sensors. These are the Nayrod magnetometers that have been commonly used in magnetic observatories. And so these are low noise sensors. What you're looking at on the right is a plot of signal and noise during a relatively quiet time with these flux gates. So this is in nanotesla per root hertz. And what you can see is through the operating range of these instruments, which is predominantly 10,000 seconds to 10 seconds, you've got 1 to 2 orders of magnitude signal to noise ratio. Of course, as you approach the short period end, the signal dives into the noise, and this is where you effectively lose your ability to get high quality responses. But there is this band in here from about 10 seconds all the way up to the Nyquist frequency, where if you have decent signal and often with some array processing, you are often able to get quality responses out in this range. So in kind of looking at the life cycle from permitting through data QA, QC, all the way to site acceptance, there's a few things to point out. Earthscope had relatively rigorous site selection criteria. There were spatial tolerances on how close to a grid point you needed to be. And a lot of effort goes in up front to avoiding cultural noise sources, pipelines, power lines, et cetera. And this is all towards trying to maintain efficiency in the field operations, as well as high quality data. In the field, right from the beginning, there was always a degree of QA/QC, looking at time series, single station, remote reference responses. Throughout much of the program, there was effectively a 10-day site visit or a checkup to see how the site was cooking. And then there's always been some component of advanced processing back in the lab to kind of make decisions on those tough cases. The actual site acceptance was based on consensus, and there were nominal requirements that within the band from 10 to 10,000 seconds, we're looking for error bars that are less than 10% in apparent resistivity and 5 degrees in phase. But there are also other factors that come into play, including the conductivity structure of the ground and the amount of cultural noise. But inevitably, this approach results in, quote, rejected stations. And at the end of the day, it's on the order of 10% of the grid points had a relocation to improve data quality. So as the program has grown, the field acquisition has gone from what was predominantly a summer operation to nearly year-round field effort. And the field operation also highlights, I think, the educational component of this, in that there's been a very close connection between the SAGE geophysical field camp and the MT array program. And over the course of this program, nearly 50 students have worked on some component of the MT array field operation. This is commonly something they pick up after they complete an undergraduate degree. And I think it speaks to speaks volumes that a number of these students have gone on to pursue graduate school in MT. And finally, as the array has kind of crisscrossed the country, this has really been a wonderful opportunity to communicate science to the public. So the data processing, the final or definitive data processing, is also a very important component of this data set. So from the beginning, the data have been processed with the EMTF processing suite developed by Gary Egbert. And so this is a suite of single station, remote reference, and multi-station array processing. There's also been a number of tools developed to sort of standardize the workflow and maintain full metadata tracking. Now on the right is just a screenshot from one of those software packages where on the x-axis, you're looking at the acquisition time for various runs, and on the y-axis, you're looking at stations. And so what's currently done is we effectively process each station with all possible references, as well as a wide range of multi-station arrays. And so often we end up with several hundred responses, which are then sifted through to identify the best short period and long period responses. And these are often not the same. Typically, your best long period response comes from either a single station or a more traditional remote reference processing, while the best short period responses are often from larger arrays where you can really kind of beat down the noise at those short periods. And then these responses are merged in the end to create the best composite response. So all of the data are made publicly available through the IRIS Data Management Center. There's a couple screenshots below of what the tool looks like to actually query and download these transfer functions. At present, there are about 1,200 stations archived, and this list is growing daily. The data are from 5 to 20,000 seconds. And this tool actually allows you to sort both geographically by location, you can sort by survey, by acquisition date. And there's another aspect here, which there's this quality factor, which has been applied to each transfer function. And it's just a 1 through 5 ranking. It's somewhat qualitative, but it allows you to get a sense of data quality and, for example, only pull stations with a quality factor greater than, say, 3, which in this case encompasses 90% of the stations which are out there. The data are available in 3 formats. They are available as Z files in their original measurement coordinates with full covariance data. They're available in geographic coordinates, both as XML data with full metadata embedded within it, as well as EDI files. The time series are also archived and fully available. And so these you can search by time, and the data are presented as mini seed format. Right, so transitioning to the data set itself, this is kind of where things stand. So if you look in the IRIS DMC today, this is effectively what you will see for the USMT array. So everything in red are the transportable array stations. The green stars are that 7 station backbone array. And then in the green squares are some USGS contributions to the grid. And so if I can start this movie, let's see, why is this not going? Huh. I apparently have lost my... There we are. You have to take the pointer off. Right, so this is a progression through time of the array. And you can see this first footprint. You recall we had targeted footprints. This is the Northwest footprint filling in. Now we're going to fill in the Midwest footprint. And so as this array has progressed along, there have been tough decisions that had to be made as to where to go. We then completed sort of the central North American central plains, and current efforts are here in the Southwest. So in addition to the actual array itself, that 1,200 stations, this array is really valuable as sort of a backbone or a consistent framework upon which to build. So I've overlain here in orange a number of PI-driven surveys. Some of these are 20, 30 years old. Some of these occurred last year. So it's really a wide variety of surveys that both predate and post-date the arrival of the MT array. But there's a lot of potential, I think, here, both for looking at some of these older stations that maybe some of these surveys were done in 2D and you can now look at them in 3D. And it also, for new surveys, provides a bit of de-risking in terms of putting a survey together, both in being able to see the regional structure up front and lowering the cost just by not having to acquire quite as many stations. So this is really, I like to think of this as a kind of a living data set that is growing daily. And it's also, you know, kind of similar to magnetics and gravity. It's really a new national scale data set that can be tapped for a number of different applications. So I'd like to look at the data a little bit in the data space. So this first plot here, we're looking at 10 seconds. So this is the shortest periods that are reliably produced across the array. And we're looking at electric field polarization ellipses. So as shown sort of schematically on the left here, these are ellipses which show the magnitude and polarization of the electric field in response to sort of a unit magnetic field variation. And the shading of these is the actual magnitude of the impedance. So it's in millivolts per kilometer per nanotesla. And if we just look kind of qualitatively at this national scale map, we can see these very large ellipses. So very large electric fields and very high impedance magnitudes over the northern mid-continent. This is where we have the exposed Archean superior craton. So really resistive rocks. Just adjacent to it, there are these very low amplitude impedances with very small electric fields. And this is over the Western Interior Seaway. So this is an area which in the Mesozoic was a marine transgression. So the ocean came in and laid down thick packages of shales. And there's a lot of other things embedded in this. You can see very polarized ellipses sort of going along the Appalachian trend. So there's a lot of linear structures running through here that cause polarization of the fields. And then in the Western US, it's a much more complicated picture. And so this is the part of the US which is tectonically active. And so as compared to the East, you kind of have this additional complexity evident just looking in at these polarization ellipses. We can also look at phase tensors, and now we're looking, we're pushing a little bit deeper in the Earth, looking at 100 seconds period. And these are here colored by the minimum principal phase. And I think the thing that really stands out to me is this region of in red here that I'm kind of outlining, where you have these high principal phases. And this is effectively marking the outline of basin and range extension. So much of the Western US is under extension. And we know that there is a highly conductive lower crust here due to a small degree of partial melt, as well as saline fluids. And that's really reflected in these elevated minimum phases. We see a similar sort of stripe running through here. This is the Rio Grande Rift, where we have Cenozoic extension. And some of these areas of high principal phase in here are corresponding to ancient sutures. So right along here is where the Grenville suture has been proposed. And even little things like up in here, there's a pretty major conductivity anomaly associated with a 1.8 billion year old suture. The last thing we'll look at in the data space here are induction vectors. So I'm again sort of going deeper into the Earth. This is a 1,000 seconds period. And these are real induction vectors in Parkinson convention. So you see kind of what you would expect at the coasts along the West Coast. Very strong coast effect. Same thing on the Atlantic passive margin, as well as pointing towards the Gulf of Mexico. There's also another number of other things to point out. There are a couple of very prominent reversals. So one of them occurs right here, right through the central US. And this is marking the North American Central Plains conductivity anomaly. This is one of the most prominent conductivity anomalies on Earth, and something we'll look at a little bit later. There's also another reversal running right through here that's corresponding to that Grenville suture. And even things like in the basin range, where we know we have sort of conductive lower crust in a very thin lithosphere, we have very small induction vectors. So up till now, we've looked in the data space, but I want to talk a little bit about what we're calling the CONUS conductivity model. So this is shown here as a snapshot of the version 1.0, if you will, of this conductivity model of the contiguous US. This was published a couple of years ago by Anna Kelbert and is something that's actively being revised. But this is really, it's a hybrid. It's a composite model based on published models. And the footprints of these are sort of shown in the lower left here. But as you can expect, these are models that were generated by various PIs with differing start models, differing regularization, cell size, et cetera. So it's not perfect. And you can see the the result of that stitch in some cases as you slice through this model, but it is a starting point. And shown here is the resistivity at 3 kilometers depth. And this is about the shallowest depths at which you can start to get somewhat reliable information out of the model. And if I just focus on this sort of area in the Midwest here, you'll see that there are some conductive areas. These correspond to thick sedimentary basins, Michigan Basin, Illinois Basin, Williston Basin. And in contrast, you have these more resistive areas where you have Precambrian crystalline basement close to the surface, here and here, and even often here in the Rocky Mountains. So there is a geologic imprint that you can get even at these shallow slices. When we look a little bit deeper here at 30 kilometers, we're now diving into the lower crust, and we can see kind of a confirmation of a lot of what we saw in the data space. So this real conductive region beneath much of the Western US, associated with basin and range extension, very sharp boundary here in Oregon. This is actually the result of the very first paper published on these data. And then there's conductors running through the center of the US here. This is sort of a fuzzy imprint of that North American Central Plains conductor, as well as a conductor along the Grenville Suture. And then looking into the mantle, really resistive Archean lithosphere beneath the Superior Craton, the Wyoming Craton. There's this big North American Central Plains conductor. And then if we look off the Western US, we see this resistor sort of snaking underneath the West Coast. That's the subducting oceanic Juan de Fuca slab. So I'm now gonna transition to kind of the few examples here. And I'm gonna first start by looking at framework tectonics. So there have been a number of models published from this data. In black are shown the outlines of the published models that I was able to locate. A lot of them focused on that initial footprint in the Pacific Northwest, a bunch focused around Yellowstone, and then more recently, a series that are kind of looking at the Midwest and Eastern Seaboard. And just as a shout out, there is also a large number of models that are kind of currently in the works and at various stages towards publication. So in looking at North America, we're gonna kind of focus in on this area shown here. And so on this geologic map in gray are the Archean cratons. So this is the old cratonic core of North America. And kind of this pinkish color are paleoproterozoic origins, which have stitched these cratons together. And then everything in the south here, kind of below this line I'm tracing out, are accreted terrains that at subsequent points in time grew the North American core. So we're gonna look at this region. So here we are. We're looking at a slice at 2 kilometers depth. It's a bit of a different color scale, so take note of that on the right. And the white dots are the station locations. And you can see that there's not just the USMT array here, but there's also a number of other studies that have been added on, I think highlighting the ability to kind of build upon this array. And so I'll just point out in particular, there's a lot of lithoprobe data up in the north, data by Martin Unsworth and colleagues from over Alberta. So in this shallowest slice, we see kind of that first order picture that we saw in the data space. Right through the center of the US, there's this sort of very conductive region associated with those marine sediments that were laid down. And there's a relatively sharp contrast right along here. And this is the edge of the Rocky Mountains. So in some cases, this is almost a knife blade, but these very resistive units. And we've got these highlights in white. These are the geologic outcrops of Precambrian. So these are specific uplifts. And you can see there's very nice correlation with the MT model. And then off to the east, where we get exposed Precambrian, it is again resistive in the near surface. So slicing a bit deeper, at 15 kilometers, you start to really see the framework that underlies these basins. So I'll point out this big conductor that's kind of running right through here. This is formed along the edge of the Superior Craton. There's another one running through here that's forming on the edge of the Wyoming Craton. And These are marking paleo subduction zones. And the model here is something that was advanced by David Berner and others back several decades ago, where in a subduction setting, when you have passive margin sediments, they can be, these are carbonaceous sediments that can be pushed to depth at high P, low T conditions, and the carbon can be converted to graphite. So you can use these conductors as effectively a marker for where past subduction has occurred. If we go a little bit deeper, these really stand out. So now in the lower crust, you can see these conductors lighting up all along the edges of several of these cratons. And this red line, which is sitting here, this is that North American Central Plains conductor. And so this was identified back in the 70s from magnetic variation data and subsequent MT studies by Alan Jones and Jim Craven and others sort of identified it at various points. However, here we're really able to kind of see it in 3D and really trace the configuration of these subduction zones. The other thing that really stands out is you can kind of trace this boundary where everything to the west of it is extremely conductive. And this is sort of marking the edge of active tectonics in the western US. So we have, again, basin range extension, and then imprinted on that is also this sort of double set of railroad tracks, these conductive tracks that I'm tracing out here. And these are along the Yellowstone Snake River Plain hotspot track. And if we take a look at this in cross section, so now these are a suite of west to east cross sections with north on the top and south on the bottom. We can again see that same basic configuration with these really thick, resistive, depleted cratonic roots for the Wyoming craton, Superior craton. And in contrast, we have much thinner lithosphere with this conductive lower crust beneath the basin range and the Snake River Plain. And embedded within it, we have these sutures, which connect these cratons, much like the mobile belts in Africa. We'll just see if we can take a quick look at one movie here. This is just a little eye candy. So we're looking north through this model, and we're effectively draining the bathtub, looking deeper into the earth. Now we're down close to 100 kilometers depth. We can see the cratons embedded in here. And then we're slicing now through it, the conductive lower crust beneath the basin range, in contrast to those cratons with the thick resistive roots. And then if we pull some isosurfaces, we're now outlining the most conductive and most resistive pieces, everything less than 25 ohmmeters and everything greater than 500 ohmmeters. And you can again see sort of these cratons surrounded by these mobile belts marking past subduction. Whoops. Right. So the last thing I want to look at on this topic is the imprint of subduction. So I've made the argument that these conductive belts are marking paleoproterozoic subduction zones. And the plot we're looking at is actually here of conductance integrated through the crustal column. And these typically have conductances in excess of 1,000 siemens. So in contrast, we have a couple of Archean sutures in the same area. And the one that I'm outlining here in particular is rather interesting because there's a lot of geologic evidence that this proceeded via subduction, similar to what we see today, but at 2.6 billion years old. And so you'll notice that the conductance along this zone is effectively nil. It's 1,000 times less than what we see in the Paleoproterozoic. So the question arises, if we're looking at subduction in the Archean, why does it have such a different signature in our MT models? And so the argument which we're putting forth here is that this is perhaps reflecting sediment-starved subduction in the Archean. And so you can ask the question of what exactly is missing here. And there's a fair amount of evidence. So on the left is just a cartoon from a study where they've shown that from oxygen isotope data, there's effectively a step change at the end of the Archean, which is consistent with the emergence of the continents from the oceans. There's also thermal modeling that's shown on the right here. And this suggests that in the Archean, that shown here in red, there was only 2 to 3% of the global area that was above sea level. But you can compare that to present day where there's about 20% of the Earth's area above sea level. So the idea here was that in the Archean, everything was pretty much beneath water. Whereas by the time you got to the Paleoproterozoic, the continents had emerged accompanied by increases in subaerial weathering, and thus providing the source material needed to provide a conductive horizon in our models to mark these subduction zones. So I'll now take a look at mineral resources. Of late, the mineral systems approach or concept has become somewhat in vogue. This has been really spearheaded a lot by folks in Australia. And the idea is to try to look not at isolated mineral deposits, but at mineral systems and look at sort of the suite of geologic processes that control their formation and sort of the progressive concentration of minerals from sort of the craton scale down to the deposit scale. And this concept recognizes sort of a number of important components, including the energy drive, the source of metals, how you transport metals and where those pathways are, as well as where you sort of trap them in ultimately form deposits. And so there's been a lot of effort of late looking at MT in particular in trying to understand and map out transport pathways at crustal and lithospheric scales. And so probably at the more simplistic level, there's a lot of effort towards kind of taking, if you will, multivariate or machine learning approaches to take numbers of different data layers and put them together to map mineral potential or prospectivity. And so on the right is just a simple example of taking some of these lower crustal conductors that have been identified and using that as one of many layers. And when you put this together with things such as magnetics and gravity and deposit locations, there's a lot of power towards refining our estimates of undiscovered mineral potential. A more statistical approach is something that's been pursued of late by Allison Kirkby and others. And shown here is just a slice at 30 kilometers depth through three different models over the parts of the US. And overlaying on it are deposits. In particular, these are three types of mineral deposits that are commonly found in convergent margins. In particular, we have volcanogenic hosted massive sulfides, porphyry deposits, and orogenic gold deposits. And so the idea here is to look statistically at the spatial relationships between these deposits and these conductivity models. And so this is kind of illustrated here. On the left is actually a piece from a conductivity model from Southeast Australia. And these gray outlines are showing basically everything less than 100 meters at a lower crustal depth slice, while the yellow dots are showing mineral occurrences. And so what Allison's approach does here is effectively looks at the cumulative distribution of deposits that fall within a certain distance of these contours, these 100 ohm meter contours. So if you're at zero, you're effectively, the deposit lies right at the contour. If you're negative, it falls within. And if it's positive, it's some distance away. So in this case, this blue line is showing that 90% of mineral deposits, in this case, fall within 25 kilometers of one of these contours. In contrast, this gray curve is what you would get if those deposits were just randomly seeded. So you can see that there's a distance between these two, and that's sort of an indication of the statistical significance of this distribution. So this has been done at one depth slice, but we can do this at a number of depths and for different deposit types, different geographic areas. And you get these heat maps that are shown here. So the rows here are the different deposit types, and the columns are the analysis for Southeast Australia and the analysis outside Australia, which includes those US models. And the effectively where you see the warmer areas, these are areas where you have higher statistical significance and spatial correlation between a particular depth range and this particular type of deposit. So in this case, for porphyry deposits, it's showing a strong correlation between the conductivity models and within the lithospheric mantle and that type of deposit. You can see different spatial relationships for different deposit types. For example, if we look at orogenic gold deposits here, we can see that there's really sort of a two zones of high correlation. One here in the lower crust and another down deeper in the mantle. So I think these relationships are important not only in advancing our ability to estimate undiscovered mineral resource potential, but also in combining them with our current understanding on the genetic models for how these deposits form. I think there's a lot that can be learned. So the last example I'm going to touch upon here is concerning space weather. And so the basic idea here is that during a geomagnetic storm, we have time-varying magnetic fields that can be quite large. And this is due to the impingement of the solar wind on the Earth's magnetosphere. And these variations, as we well know from MT, are filtered through the Earth, and that filter is the impedance. And so after going through the impedance, we get the surface geoelectric field. And if we do this in the time domain, this is a simple convolution between the impedance and the magnetic field. So once you have that surface electric field, you can actually start to look at that together with man-made infrastructure. So in this case, we're going to be looking at the impacts on the electric power grid. So for the power grid, you have transmission lines, which are grounded periodically, typically at substations. And we can calculate the voltage on any given transmission line as the line integral of that surface electric field along it. And so that again is the voltage on one of these lines due to this geomagnetic activity. So these voltages drive quasi-DC currents that can flow within the power grid during a geomagnetic storm. And they typically again enter into the power grid at substations through the groundings on transformers, but their impact can be quite deleterious. They can trigger cascading failures and widespread blackouts. So the approach that I'm going to talk about here and what we're really looking to do is come up with some estimate of the hazard to the US national power grid. And the way we're going to do this is really by combining sort of three data sets. First is the magnetic observatories that are shown in stars. And this is where we have long records of magnetic time series. We also have the MT array stations in blue, and then the imprint of the US power network is in orange as transmission lines. And this is a study that was recently published by Greg Lucas and others. So the first stage of this is identifying geomagnetic storms. And to do this, we're looking at series of magnetic indices. So in the top here is KP, and the bottom is DST. So again, these are measures of geomagnetic activity that are derived from magnetic observatory data. And it's a little hard to see, but these orange segments are those that through this approach have been deemed geomagnetic storms for this study. So we're looking over, in this case, a 30-year period. So for each individual magnetic storm, however, we can then take and effectively map the magnetic field onto the electric field and ultimately onto line voltages. So on the left here is an interpolated magnetic field for about 3 hours during one of these particular storms. And then we can take that interpolated mag field together with our MT array impedance data to calculate surface electric fields as a function of time. And you can see as we go along here, throughout the course of the storm, different areas light up at different times. And then again, taking this data and doing that line integral, we can calculate voltages on the US electric power grid as a function of time. So this is for one storm. So to actually get a hazard map, what we're ultimately aiming for here is a 100-year occurrence map. So we're looking to get a handle on what is the electric field at each of, at various parts of the country that may be expected to be exceeded once per 100 years. So we can look at the distribution of electric fields to do that. So what's shown on this plot are cumulative distributions of the peak E fields that occurred in each of those storms. So to read this off, you can effectively say that at this particular station, this is a station in Colorado, the electric field exceeded 0.1 volts per kilometer on average 10 times per year. So in looking at this, what we see first is that there are extreme differences between stations. So these two stations are less than 100 kilometers apart. However, their electric fields, surface electric fields during these storms vary by almost two orders of magnitude. So this tells us right here that solid earth conductivity is a primary driver behind the variations we see in GIC hazards. We can further extrapolate these data to that 100-year exceedance field. So this arrow is showing once per 100 years, and there's a couple of different statistical extrapolations shown here. So we can do this for each station and thus create a map something like this. So this is again showing that 100-year geoelectric field exceedance, and it's independent at this point of human infrastructure. It's just based off of the empty array stations. We see very large values over the northwestern, the northern mid-continent, where we again have these resistive Archean cratons. We also see high E-field exceedance values over the crystalline Appalachians. And in contrast, over the basin range where we have conductive lower crust, we see very low values. So this is again primarily geologically driven, but there is a bit of a secondary overprint from the variations in the magnetic field. And here we've now added on that imprint of the power network. So this is now those line voltages that are calculated from those surface E fields. And we can again see very strong variations. There's also in some cases, you can see the effects of polarization due to both the geology underlying the area as well as the network geometry. So there are cases where east-west lines have considerably higher 100-year exceedance voltages than north-south lines. So I think that's pretty much it. I'm gonna wrap up here with just a few comments. So I think the US MT Array is really valuable. It's a consistent, publicly available data set that's nearing completion within the contiguous US. As I hopefully have shown, the data and the models that are derived from them are really helping to advance our understanding of a number of different areas. And stepping back for a minute, the MT Array program, I think, has really increased the prominence of MT, at least in the US, both within the greater earth science community, as well as kind of exposing a new generation of students to magnetotellurics. And finally, I want to really call out the fact that this has been a group effort, and there have been a number of people involved over the last decade and a half. The National Science Foundation had multiple program managers who really made this happen. Oregon State University has had an outsized role in making this effort come off. And I want to particularly acknowledge Adam Schultz and Gary Egbert. IRIS had a really large role in overseeing a lot of the effort and helping the get the on the data front to actually get a clean back end to serve up these data. Luis Pellerin with Green Geophysics has done a fabulous job in overseeing the day-to-day operations of a lot of this. There have been a number of people as well on various fronts who really sustained this effort. And then lastly, the many dedicated field people who kept this monumental effort going. So with that, thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Paul. I'm sure that you've got, how many people, 50 of people clapping right now. Absolutely wonderful presentation. That's a brilliant, brilliant program. You know, it's, and one of the fabulous aspects is that all the data are publicly available to anybody and the whole world can look at it. I've got 58 questions I'm going to ask. Well, that's not fair. I'll just ask one if you don't mind, and it's following on from something you commented, and then we'll go to the, you know, a lot of questions are rolling in. So it's a generic one. If you go back one slide, you just talked about the prominence of MT. And I think there's no doubt that, was it 20 years ago that MT was called a cottage industry? I remember that phrase being used in one review of one of your proposals, or not your proposal, one of the MT community's proposal, but it's certainly grown way beyond that. It's a significant community. Is that translating into sustainable growth? I mean, are you seeing in the US more interest for hiring MT people in faculty positions?
Yeah, that's a good question. And at the risk of jinxing things, I think the answer is yes. I mean, there's at least a handful of folks who are now in various tenure track and research positions in universities. And I think the thing which I find most striking is, for the longest time, I felt like there was a bit of a catch-22 where to get an MT faculty position, you had to be at a university which already had an MT person to really advocate for it, which meant they had to be retiring because no university would pick up two. But a couple of these recent hires have been at places which have not had an existing MT faculty member. So I think there has been progress on that front, and I'm rather optimistic.
Oh, wonderful. Well, let's go to questions. Leo posed one, actually. Leo Fox of Phoenix Geophysics, he posed one about 20 minutes ago. And sorry, Leo, you've been having to wait. The current subducting oceanic plate below the West Coast is resistive, but the ancient mid-continental subduction zones are conductive. Why the difference?
That's a good question, Leo. And I probably needed to have been a little clearer. So the actual subducting plate is in most cases shows up as highly resistive. The conductors that we're seeing as kind of, if you will, markers of past subduction are really related to the passive margin sediments that are being scraped off and subducted along with them, with the plate. So it's effectively the presence of these passive margin sediments and their transport to depth, which is what is needed. And it appears that, you know, some of these sediments get left behind at lower crustal depths long after subduction has ceased.
Yeah, perhaps if I could just carry on the discussion, because you mentioned the difference in the Archean and some of those subduction zones, late Archean subduction zones didn't seem to have a conductive feature associated with them. But even today, we're seeing on the Nazca Plate, for example, we're seeing a sediment-starved subduction, right? And that's not showing very strong conductivity anomalies close to the coast. You don't see anything like what you see under the Juan de Fuca, for example.
Yeah, no, and that's a good point. I mean, the absence of sediments does not necessarily, it doesn't strictly imply that you, it doesn't strictly imply that you didn't have subduction going on or that subduction was different. And that is one of the limitations. And even when you look at sort of shield terrains where you have ocean island arcs that have been slammed together via oceanic subduction, you don't necessarily see this. It seems like you need a long-lived continental passive margin to develop just a real thick sediment layer. And then you obviously need the right, you know, geometry for subduction, I think, to bring some of it down. So yeah, you're right. The absence of it is not, you know, sort of conclusive evidence that something was different in the Archean.
Makoya Didas says, amazing presentation, Paul. And I think we all think that, Makoya. How were you able to eliminate the noise from stations located in big cities?
Yeah, that's a good question. One of the things I'll note up front is that the number of stations that were relocated along the eastern seaboard, where we have the major population centers, was considerably higher. So there was a lot of effort put forth to try to find quiet locations. To some degree, there's the situation is not too bad just in that we're doing long period data acquisition. If we were doing wideband, the higher frequencies, I think, would be pretty compromised in a lot of the areas, just due to the frequency spectrum of a lot of cultural noise. So there has been a lot of effort made towards trying to find quiet areas. There's been a lot of relocations, and there's been a lot of effort towards kind of sifting through the time series, finding less contaminated time periods using array processing. But it does remain a problem in some areas. And there have been a handful of grid points which ultimately have been abandoned. Just their areas around Los Angeles and San Diego, for example, have proved nearly impossible to get quality data.
Elliot Eaton is asking, thanks again for the great presentation, Paul. What are the next steps for the space weather hazard research using MT sites?
That's an interesting question. And I think others who are doing research in this area might answer differently, but I can maybe just talk a little bit on, you know, some of the areas that we've been looking into. There's a current effort that is looking at the impact of spatial scale of the data. So this is much of what we've been looking at is with 70 kilometer space data, but there are areas where if you have a sharp conductivity contrast, you may need considerably finer resolution data in order to truly understand those hazards. And though I didn't actually show it, one of the examples that comes out is you'll see in this map here, there's a bit of a hot spot right in the center of Colorado. And that is to some degree, that sits pretty much over the city of Denver. So as a major metropolitan area, seeing that there's a big hot spot there is somewhat concerning, but we've now done some high resolution studies there and can effectively show that it's the station distribution and the distribution of those stations in relation to a major conductivity boundary that control that. So I would say issues of scale are one topic. I think there's a lot of opportunity to try to take this a little bit further in not stopping at the line voltages, which is what we've done, but working with regional power industries who know their network topology, their grounding resistances, and all the sort of operational aspects of their network to actually compare it to measured GIC data. So there's a validation effort, which is quite important. And then maybe the last thing I'll just say is a lot of the methodology that's been developed here for looking at magnetic storms can equally well be applied to EMP or electromagnetic pulse. And there's a lot of concern of late on modeling the hazardous effects of EMP on the same infrastructure. So those are just a few areas where I think you could take this sort of research.
If I understand it, Paul, you're generating those electric fields from GICs through using a non-uniform source field and putting that through transfer functions that have been calculated using a uniform source field.
Okay, so you're right. The magnetic field is strictly not uniform. I mean, you can look at the this map here and say that's not a uniform source field. But over the areas, so we've done some looking at kind of the period range in the skin depths for kind of a range of reasonable earth conductivities. And it is approximately, for most of the times that we're looking at, it is approximately a uniform source field. There is some degree of approximation though, you're right, because we are using plane wave impedances with a strictly non-uniform source field. But again, we've kind of run the numbers and it's a pretty good approximation is what it comes out to.
Yeah, you probably get away with it in the US, but you couldn't get away with it in Canada.
Yeah, no, I mean, you can see as this movie goes through, there's some areas in Canada where you get pretty abrupt transitions. And yeah, as you go to higher latitude, I think some of these assumptions will break down.
So Leo replied back, yes, he said, this about the structure, but vast quantities of very conductive seawater are subducted, whether active or passive margins. So the question remains. Yeah.
Yeah. I guess my comment on that is by the time you get down to, you know, there's a number of mechanisms by which you can get elevated conductivity coming off a subducting slab, and you know, sort of the release of pore waters through just, you know, compaction and pore collapse happens pretty shallow, well into the fore arc in these subduction zones. So you know, there is some high conductivity associated with the release of those of seawater, but by the time you get into the lower crust, that's long gone. And then in these passive margins, once you get into an ancient tectonic regime, you really don't have the ability to store appreciable amounts of water at mid to lower crustal conditions.
Abbas Fanei asks, thank you very much. How do you merge your MT sites? And 11-year solar cycle doesn't affect your data conditions and processing, he asks.
Yeah, so the merging is actually relatively simple. It is a straight merge by period. So we'll often overlay a number of different responses and just, you know, actually just put a cut at period and stitch the two curves together. Occasionally we have to do more complex merging. You can imagine if you had a lovely 3-week data set and one dipole got cut after 4 days, you would want to use the full data set to, you know, get one mode and the 4 days to get the other mode. So we do sometimes do mode stitching, but in general, it's just taking the short periods from one and the long periods from another and stitching them together.
I guess a clever way of stitching it would be to use Rho plus, something like that, you know, just in case you've got amplitude differences, static shift amplitude differences.
Yep, you could certainly, you know, do something more sophisticated than what we're doing. And I guess as for the 11-year solar cycle question, you know, there are differences in particular in the long period activity, but generally the 3-week minimum is sufficient even during solar minimum to, you know, there's enough background long period activity that even during solar minimum, you can usually get a solid response out to 10,000 seconds, with exceptions being when you're over extremely conductive ground.
Okay, we have three questions from Syed Mohammed Abtai Furushani. And thanks for your presentation. Here's my question. Is 1 hertz sampling rate enough for plate tectonics research? You have areas with high resistivity, such as Rocky Mountains, with thick crust, hence using a small sample rate means you would lose vertical resolution. It would be problematic, especially when the subduction zone is not so deep. Of course, for mineral exploration purposes, this sampling rate is not sufficient at all.
Yeah, you know, it depends. Obviously, in some of the more resistive areas, especially as you get further north into the Superior Craton, you're definitely losing information about the near surface. You know, if you're primarily concerned with kind of crustal architecture, though, a lot of these boundaries seem to show up predominantly in the lower crust. So even in these resistive terrains, I think these data are still pretty relevant for tectonic scale research. You know, your point about mineral exploration is certainly valid. You know, in a lot of cases, the upper kilometer is where you're really interested in from a mineral exploration perspective. And yeah, these data are pretty limited there. So, you know, building upon them with more high resolution wideband data would be the way to go in most cases.
Yeah, and I think you touched on it right there, Paul. You know, you've got 70 kilometer station spacing, so there's really no point having high frequencies.
Yeah. That, of course, you're extremely spatially aliased by the time you look, if you're looking shallow.
The second question from Syed, are the resistivity maps you have shown in the presentation planned sections of a 3D resistivity model, or was it just interpolated 1D models? I think you answered that, really. You said it's a stitch of various 3Ds.
Yeah, those are all from 3D models.
Okay, and then finally from Syed, I would like to see some comparisons between the cross sections of the estimated resistivity extracted from MMT data and seismic profiles or magnetic susceptibility cross sections. Have you done such studies?
So we've done a little bit of looking at comparing some of the MT inversions to magnetic susceptibility cross sections. So there are some folks who have been working on 3D grav mag inversions. And so we've done a little bit of comparison in some of those cases. And there's some similarity, but also the magnetic and gravity inversions have, you know, more challenges on depth control. Due to the nature of that potential field problem. I think the comparison to seismic there's a real opportunity there, especially with the rise of ambient noise tomography. And the sort of models that are coming out of ANT studies are, I think, particularly well suited for comparison with MT in that they actually see a bit of the upper or lower crust. You know, a lot of the body wave seismic studies and traditional seismic studies really work well in the mantle, but in the absence of considerable seismicity, don't have a lot to say about the crust. So I think the advent of these ambient noise tomography models really is a bit of an untapped opportunity.
And one now from Jan Avram, who's at Phoenix Geophysics. He says, thanks, Paul and Alan. These weekly seminars are great. Well, thank you, Jan. If this whole program would be repeated with a similar budget, what would you suggest to do to improve efficiency, data quality, and the results?
That's
a very interesting question.
Well, yeah, that's a good question. And, you know, my answer may be somewhat different than, you know, it's sort of the answer that the folks who are actually on the ground might say, but you know, there's a couple things I guess that I would mention. I think a larger number of instruments would really help. This program has been supported by a pretty small pool of instruments, and unfortunately there were also instruments which you know, are no longer manufactured, so there's been a lot of effort cost associated with kind of keeping them up to date.
You'd like to see a lot of very affordable MT systems. Now, if only people from Phoenix would listen to this.
Yeah, if only, right? the other thing I guess I'd comment on, and this is something which we are starting to do and will hopefully be sort of taken up within the MT array within this the next couple of months here, is the use of simple things like status of health monitors. So this is something that we at the USGS have been using for a couple of years now. Just the ability to be more efficient in your station visits. So I mentioned that many of these stations had a sort of a checkup visit after 10 days, using pretty simple sort of status of health monitors allows you to only visit the stations that need it, the ones that got an electric line cut after 2 days. And so I think there's some field efficiency that could be worked in on things like that.
Yeah, certainly with Elon Musk's Starnet, you get very cheap broadband. You can get the data in real time.
Yeah, and I'm not sure I'd say that there's a, I guess it, my opinion would be that the primary thing is getting that status of health information to know that your battery is still alive and your sensor is intact and your instrument hasn't been dug up. I think getting real-time data telemetry is helpful, but I would say, in my opinion, that's maybe of secondary importance.
That's, there we are, another one. From Akoya Adidas again, I believe you also performed 1D inversion. If so, what was the major difference between 1D and 3D? Well, you could probably talk for another hour.
Yeah. So we haven't actually done 1D inversion on these data. Certainly all the examples I showed for looking at tectonics and mineral resources, those are all the result of 3D inversions. We have done some 1D inversions in the space weather domain just to kind of compare some of the results. There has within the space weather community been a history of using 1D impedances for GIC calculations. And so we've done some there just to, if you will, show how wrong it is. Mm-hmm. There are parts of the US which are approximately 1D, but I would say they're few and far between. When you get to these long periods, you're averaging over such large spatial areas that it's rarely layer cake. So yeah, we pretty much are entirely in 3D.
Well, thanks very much, Paul. You've answered all the questions. So on behalf of everybody, I'd just like to thank you. One more from Syed. In 3D inversion, what was the smallest block size in your mesh? And what RMS misfit did you get?
Yeah, so the 3D inversions I've shown are all with a 10-kilometer cell size. So, you could argue that is a little bit finer than the data really support, given that it's a 70-kilometer station spacing. Sort of the philosophy I've taken is to have a relatively granular mesh such that when you look in the near surface, you can actually see the impact of the spatial aliasing. So you can see kind of a speckled model. And while it can be somewhat distracting, I find it actually kind of just reveals the reach of the data. So it's been 10 kilometers throughout. And the RMS misfits have been on the order of two and a half in some cases. And starting misfits are usually on the order of 50 to 70. So it's about a 80 to 90% reduction in misfit from sort of starting half space to final model.
Great, thanks, Paul. So I'd like to close this now, and I'll just remind people, let me just get the screen back from you.
Yep.
Just remind people that next week we have presentation on Razorback by Pierre Warzyniak, and hopefully he'll tell me how to pronounce his name. Sorry, Pierre. And Farid Smay on this open source Python library. So I'd like to end the seminar and thank everybody for coming, and I'll see you next week. Bye for now. Take care. Stay safe.